Welcome back to MarkusPix. Today I am going to be reviewing what are, in my opinion, the best portrait lenses, all around lenses to use, especially for portraits. And I'm going to be focusing a lot on the 50 millimeter range. Why? Because if you're only going to get one lens, if you can only afford one lens for everything, the all around purpose lens, it would be a 50 millimeter. It's not too narrow and it's not too wide. It doesn't distort the face like a 35 would if you were sitting close to someone at a restaurant or something. And it's not so telephoto that you only, you know, you have to be 500 feet back to see the person. 50 millimeter is a really good size all around. Most professional photographers, when they do portraits, they prefer around 85 because it makes the background go a little bit out of focus, which puts more emphasis on the foreground. But nowadays they're coming out with 50 millimeters where the background is just as out of focus or even more than the 85s that have been used up till now. So that's what I'm going to be showing you, all the comparisons, exactly what the pictures look like, how much they cost, how much they weigh, what the size is, everything that you want to know about portrait lenses. Now I use Sony. I used to use Canon, I now use Sony because it is the lightest, smallest, full frame camera you can get. It's sharper than anything else out there and it's got features that nothing else can even touch. But most of these lenses can be adapted to Canon, Nikon and something like that. And I will be testing also Canon and Nikon lenses in this test. Now let's talk about blurry background for a minute. Everybody loves to use the word bokeh. Bokeh doesn't necessarily mean how blurry a background is. When it really comes into play is how it also handles actual light sources like light bulbs and candles. You can see in the test images, this is noticeably different in the various lenses. Note the size and shape of each color blob. Some have sharp edges while others have softer edges. The Mitakon and to some degree the Rokinon lenses are the only ones that have soft edge on the bokeh balls. This actually helps make the background more pleasant and less distracting, while the more expensive professional lenses have much sharper bokeh ball edges. All the test pictures were taken with a full frame Sony A7S2, and some were taken with a 6300 just to see what the APSC crop sensor looks like. My goal was to find the best lens for blurring the background for portraits, with preference for how lightweight the lens is, how small it is, and how easy it is to use. Photography should be fun, so the fun factor is just as important to me as the technical, how sharp the picture is and all that stuff. Until recently, the main way to get a blurry background was simply to use a telephoto lens. Now, telephoto lenses are really big and heavy and expensive, and you need to get way back from the subject. But a lot of the times when I do portraits, it's spontaneous. It's something that's unexpected. I'm just walking around with somebody, and it's just a beautiful moment. My background's just right, the lighting's just right, and I go, hold it, just a minute, let me take a picture. I want to have a lens ready to go that's able to do a great portrait that puts the background out of focus. And that's usually what I carry around, is around a 50 millimeter lens. Now, to make the background out of focus with a 50 millimeter, you have to have a very small f-stop number, like a 1.4, 1.2, or even in the case of the Mitakon, 0.95. which is unheard of. That's one of the factors that's important to me when choosing a really cool, spontaneous portrait lens that you can carry around with you at all times. I did a bunch of research, and as you can see, I bought a whole bunch of lenses. A lot of them are expensive and a lot of them are cheap. Now, I wanted to go through everything. I wanted to see what was out there, what was the best. I tried the big brands, Sony, Nikon, Canon, and I also bought some of the smaller, lesser known, under the radar Renegade lenses. So I'm going to show you what the pictures look like, what they cost, and all that stuff. I shot all lenses wide open. That means all the way to f1.2 or however wide open the lens can go. And I shot it under both extremes, at night with twinkly lights in the background and during the day in bright sunlight. Now, the thing about bright sunlight is when you're at 1.2 or something like that, you need a filter over the front to darken the lens more or you're just going to get white. So I put a polarizing filter on all the daylight shots to test those. I use polarizing instead of ND because I have more polarizing filters that fit everything rather than ND filters. So here are my findings after doing tests with all of them, and you can download the pictures and see the comparisons yourself. The basic Sony 55mm f1.8 is actually quite good as a starting lens because it's so tiny. It's super light, very sharp, super fast autofocus, and the background blur bokeh is pretty decent. It is $900, but if you want something small and light and super sharp, instant focus, it doesn't get smaller, lighter, and better and sharper than this. Especially for traveling where you just want something small and portable. If you're just gonna have one lens, this would be it. Overall, the Sony lenses are by far the sharpest and the fastest at autofocusing. It's like almost instantaneous. 50 millimeter 1.4, the 55 millimeter 1.8, the 85 millimeter Zeiss Batis 1.8, and the 70-200 f2.8. So here's a daylight picture with the 50 millimeter 1.4. The background's a little bit more blurred than the 1.8. Not much, just a little. Here we have the 85 Sony Zeiss Batis 1.8. This one hits the golden middle of everything. Lightweight, small, blurry background, fast. And here is the big heavy 70-200, classic telephoto. Expensive, big, heavy, and a hassle to lug around. Here's the night pictures. Here again is the 55 1.8. Here is the 50 1.4, the 85 1.8, and the 70-200.
The Canon lenses, the 50 and the 85 1.2, created more softer images and had slightly more blurry background since they were f.2 as opposed to Sony's f1.4 and 1.8. But since they were Canon lenses, it required adapters which made them bigger, bulkier, and the autofocus was so slow I had to manually focus. It was kind of frustrating. The Sony lenses were much, much sharper and brighter in the viewfinder than the Canon lenses. Compared to Sony, the Canon lenses are big, heavy, they're not as sharp, they have slow, frustrating focus, and they're not fun to work with. But the images had a nicer, warmer, more magical feel than the Sony ones did.
Here's the Zeiss 85 next to the Canon 85. You can see how the Canon picture's a little softer and more cozier to look at, whereas the Zeiss is sharper, typical for Germans.
If I was going for dependability, speed, sharpness, lightweight, small size, and fun, it would be hands down Sony. If I wanted softer, more magical images, then I'd choose the Canon lenses. The Sony 50mm 1.4 and the Canon 1.2, I don't know, they're just too big and heavy and expensive, and I will probably never use them. And I suggest you guys get a smaller, more lightweight, less expensive, more fun lens than either one of these. I expected the 50mm 1.2 Nikon to look good, but it was one of the worst of the bunch. Maybe I got a bad lens or something, I don't know. But it was one of the least sharp lenses of all of them. Chromatic aberration was out of control, and it's just unusable for me. Maybe it was the adapter, I don't know, but I was using an expensive Metabones adapter. Another unusable lens was the SLR Magic. It's a cheap 50mm 1.1 lens that makes things look like an old washed out 1950s faded greenish blue postcard. If you like that retro look, this would be a good lens for that. One of my favorite portrait lenses of all is the Sigma 135 1.8. It's big, it's heavy, but what a performer. It's very sharp in the viewfinder. It takes pictures very similar to the Sony 70-200 f2.8. Beautiful blurry backgrounds, some telephoto-like background compression, and it works pretty well with Sony's autofocus and even the eye recognition.
If I really want to make some impressive pictures, I usually grab the 135. It is a Sigma, which means I need an adapter, but I don't care. It's worth it.
Of course, the expensive Sony and Canon lenses work pretty good. They better for that kind of money. But there are some high bokeh lenses that cost less, are smaller, lighter, and have even more blurry backgrounds than the big expensive ones. Part of the reason they are smaller, lighter, and cheaper is because they're manual lenses. Autofocus requires more parts and complexity. And that doesn't bother me. What bothers me is having to buy big, heavy autofocus lenses and not be able to use the autofocus like the Canon lenses because they require an adapter. So here are the small, fun, lightweight, super blurry background lenses.
There's three of them.
The Rokinon 50mm 1.2,
the German-made Voigtlander 40mm 1.2,
and the Mitakon Zhangi Speedmaster 50mm f0.95. Yes, 0.95. The Mitakon is full frame and the Rokinon is APSC crop, but it still works with full frame cameras. Hang tight, I'll get to that in a minute.
The Mitakon has the blurriest backgrounds of all the lenses. If you know how to use it right, it's an amazing lens. The color needs some adjusting, but the depth of field of this lens is just mind-blowing. You can take some pretty darn amazing pictures with this once you get used to it. The Voigtlander 40mm 1.2 has better color and is sharper than the Mitakon, but the background is not as blurry. But again, the color is a little better and it's a little sharper because it is a German lens.
The Mitakon still has a better bokeh at 1.4 than the Voigtlander does at 1.2. f0.95 is almost going too far. At that setting, the depth of field is so shallow, the tip tip of someone's eyelash may be sharp, but the eyeball is out of focus. It's like there's no room for play in there. It's very, very, very difficult to get sharp pictures of a person at f0.95, especially handheld. Plus, most lenses are not really that sharp anyway at that setting. I found that f1.2 or 1.4 is a much better setting for portraits. The lens is sharper at that setting, and you can get a whole head in focus while still having an extremely blurry background. The Voigtlander 40mm 1.2 is a good smaller size lens which seems to have more punch than the Mitakon. Voigtlander images have more contrast and darker darks than the Mitakon. The Voigtlander seems to be better for interiors, like warmer and punchier tones, than the Mitakon, which seems to be more suited for outdoors, maybe, than the Voigtlander. The Voigtlander actually speaks to the Sony, allowing it to auto-magnify when focusing. The Mitakon does not. So, to sum up these two lenses, the Voigtlander is higher quality in look, sharpness, and darks, but the Mitakon has much blurrier backgrounds. Depends which is more important to you. The Mitakon Zhangi is quite heavy because it's pure metal and glass. There's no plastic, so it's very sturdy and very solidly built, but it's heavy. My favorite of this bunch is the Rokinon 50mm 1.2. It's small, it creates great blurry backgrounds, and it's the best lens that I've found to have on my 6300 or any of the 6000 series at all times when I walk around or travel, because it's a great small lens and camera combo.
Look at the similarity between a $380 Rokinon hooked to a 6300 with a $1200 Sigma 135 on a Sony A7 R2. It's very similar. And then the 6300 with the Rokinon's a lot smaller and lighter and cheaper. It's a great travel tool to take around. But you can still use it with full frames like the A7 and A9.
Although it's APS-C, which creates vignetting and dark edges on full-frame cameras like the A7 series, so just put the camera into APS-C Super 35 mode, which is still better than shooting with an APS-C camera. It's sharper, it has a blurrier background, and a bit more of a telephoto effect than the 6300 would, and it still looks fantastic with the A7 series. This is one lens you won't mind switching your A7 into APS-C mode for. Color is not as perfect as the Sony lenses, but the creamy look it gives is just so dang addicting. I also have a Panasonic Lumix GX8 as a playing around camera. It's a crop camera. I have a 42.5mm f1.2, which is like a Sony 85 full frame. It's pretty darn good at blurring the background, but the camera has nowhere near the pro features and look of the Sony's. So my summary is this. If you're doing critical, serious, professional work, it's the Zeiss Batis 85mm f1.8. Then the Sigma 135 f1.8, and maybe the 70-200 2.8. If it's down to just one lens and nothing else, it's the Zeiss 85 1.8. It's the sharpest, most dependable, instant, fast focusing, great portrait lens you can get. And it's very lightweight, and it's pretty small to boot, too. My favorite playing around in vacation lenses are the Rokinon 50mm 1.2 paired with the 6300 because it's small and lightweight, and the A7 Mitakon Zhangi 50mm f0.95 set to around f1.3, and the Voigtlander. It's a close second because it does the auto close up when focusing, and it's sharper than the Mitakon, and it has punchier darks. But the Mitakon has blurrier backgrounds than the Voigtlander, and I'm a sucker for that. The Canon 85 1.2 has a really nice look to it, great bokeh, but it's heavy and bulky, and that's why I don't carry it around with me when I'm just randomly going somewhere, just walking around town.
So the Zeiss Batis 85mm 1.8 is the best all-around, all-purpose, sharp, fast, dependable, autofocus, good bokeh lens. It focuses instantly. It knows what it's doing. It's super sharp. Color is perfect. It speaks instantly to the Sony. For the best dramatic looks, it's the Sigma 135 1.8. It gives you that telephoto look, and it's sharp and autofocuses fast even with an adapter. It puts the background nicely out of focus, and I always end up going wow when I look through the viewfinder when I'm using the 135. The best blurry backgrounds, especially in the 50mm range, is the Mitakon Zhangi 50mm 0.95 set around f1.3. The most surprising results come from the Rokinon 50mm 1.2. The best pleasure to use is the Zeiss 85 1.8. The best autofocus, again the Zeiss 85 1.8. 8, the best classic bokeh look are the Canon 85 1.2, the Sigma 135 1.8, and the Mitakon Zhangi 50mm 0.95. The most magical, pleasant, warm look is the Canon 85 1.2. The most lightweight lens by far is the tiny 55 1.8. Now the backgrounds aren't super blurry, so for that, the most lightweight is the Rokinon paired with the 6300, or if you have an A7, the Zeiss 85 1.8. The best around town and travel lens, the Rokinon 50mm 1.2, or the Sony 55 1.8 if you want autofocus. And the best lens to grab in a panic if you can't think straight, the Zeiss 85 1.8. Will never let you down. And here's the prices from the most expensive to the least expensive. Of course, the big heavy telephoto is the most expensive, the Sony 70-200 f2.8 at over $2,500. The Canon 85 f1.2, $1,900. The Panasonic Lumix Leica 42.5 f1.2 coming in at $1,600. The big heavy 50mm Sony f1.4 at $1,400. The Canon 50mm 1.2, $1,300. For that size and that price and that weight, I would pass. Go for the 85 or something else. And now we start getting into the lenses I like. The Sigma 135 f1.8 at $1,300. The Sony 85 f1.8 Zeiss Batis at $1,200. The tiny lightweight all-purpose Sony 55 f1.8, $900. The small manual German Voigtlander 40mm 1.2 at $900. The Mitakon Zhangi 50mm f0.95 at $800. The Nikon 50mm 1.2, which I do not recommend, is $700. The amazing Rokinon 50mm f1.2 is only $380. So one of my favorite lenses is actually one of the cheapest. If you don't have any money, get the Rokinon. It's lightweight, small, fun, and only $380. And get it even if you have money. It's a fun extra lens. The SLR Magic, which is not that magical from my experience, the 50mm 1.2, $280. And if you have a Sony 6000 series, like a 6300, 6500, the APS-C little lightweight tiny 50mm f1.8 is only $250. You can't beat a lens like this for $250. It doesn't make the blurriest backgrounds, but it's a super cheap, great start lens for anybody just starting. So there you go. I have all of this on a downloadable file on the link below where you can compare the pictures and see the prices and everything. So I think I covered all grounds of what to consider when you're looking for the best all-around portrait lens to have. I've got almost all of them. I do all this testing to help you pick. If you're only gonna have one, which one are you gonna get? And some of these I might even give away because I don't need this many. I'm a hobbyist, so yeah, I mean, I might play around with some of them, but some of them I end up finding I'm not really using them that much, so I give them away. So keep watching this channel. For a matter of fact, if you watch this video to this point, I'm gonna reward you for watching this video. I'm gonna give somebody this little headset here, the omnidirectional head-worn microphone. It's just a little gift. It's nothing super expensive or special, but for watching this video, I told you I'm gonna give a lot of free stuff away. If you're doing presentations in front of people, this is a great thing to have, especially with a wireless mic system, which I'll be reviewing also later. So I'll just say the first person to say something nice will get this. All right, you gotta live in the United States and you can't have won anything already. So if you live in the United States, you haven't won anything yet, I'll send you this head-worn microphone to use in your presentations when you tell people about how much you've learned from me at MarkusPix.com. Stay tuned for the next great educational fun. We all love photography. Let's enjoy this together. I'm gonna do everything I can to enlighten you to what I find is out there, what I personally use, what I think are the best, fastest, lightest, just great fun to use equipment. Stay tuned to MarkusPix and see you next time.